How are y'all doing this morning? This morning I want to start off by reading Psalm 103, and I'm reading out of the NLT. It says, "Let all that I am praise the Lord. With my whole heart I will praise his holy name. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things he does for me. He forgives all my sins and heals all my diseases. He redeems me from death and crowns me with love and tender mercies. He fills my life with good things. My youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord gives righteousness and justice to all who are treated unfairly. He revealed his character to Moses and his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and merciful, slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love. He will not constantly accuse us nor remain angry forever. He does not punish us for all our sins. He doesn't deal harshly with us as we deserve. For his unfailing love toward those who fear him is as great as the height of the heavens above the earth. He has removed our sins as far as the east is from the west. The Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to those who fear him. For he knows how weak we are and remembers that we are only dust. Our days on earth are like grass. Like wildflower, we bloom and die. The wind blows and we are gone, as though we had never been here. But the love of the Lord remains forever with those who fear him. His salvation extends to the children's children of those who are faithful to his covenant and of those who obey his commandments. The Lord has made the heavens his throne. From there he rules over everything. Praise the Lord, you angels, you mighty ones who carry out his plans, listening for each of his commands. Yes, praise the Lord, you armies of angels who serve him and do his will. Praise the Lord, everything he has created, everything in all his kingdom. Let all that I am praise the Lord." I love that he begins and ends with just saying, "Let all that I am praise the Lord." And you know, normally we start with something a little faster, but this morning I want us to start with the song Glad Adoration, and we've done it a couple of times. But I just want us to just come to God, just telling him that we just want to praise him and worship him. So will you stand up with me and sing, let's sing this song together.
So let every breath, let every breath.
Songs, I really just wanted to focus on us just declaring God's holiness and how just good and perfect he was and just how deserving he is of our worship. And that's what these next two songs are also talking about. And I just want us to go into this time of prayer together before we sing these next two. So if you bow your heads and close your eyes with me. God, I thank you so much for this day. Worship you through music. You are so good and so worthy of our praise. And I pray that you would please just help us to remember that as we sing to you, God. Lord, I pray that you would just meet us where we are right now and help us to glorify you in all that we are singing
all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever.
And if you've been forgiven, and if you've been
to the
saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus for our sake you died. Praise the Father.
Good morning. Great to be with you this morning. Thankful that you made the great choice to come and to worship the Lord in person this morning. Just can't express how much it does my heart good to be able to be here with you. There's nothing like church family. I've come to, I believe God's given me a passion and a love for the church and an understanding of just how important it is for us to have brothers and sisters in Christ in our lives, and how too hard this world is to be able to go through it without having those of like mind, like heart, like values, that have a passion for the Lord, have a passion to live our lives out the way that He would have us to. It doesn't mean that we're perfect, but it means that we're striving to be more and more like Christ. I mean, that's ultimately what God's desire is for us, is to conform us to the image of Christ. And so I pray that you're seeking Him every day and giving Him the attention that He deserves, because the more attention we give Him, the more He is able to bless us. He's more able to change our hearts and to fill our hearts with more of Him and less of us, to push us out and to increase in Him. I want to ask you this morning, have you all heard? Have you heard? Good question. Have you heard? The 2024 presidential election is coming up this fall, and it's going to be the most critical an important one of our lifetimes. At least that's what you and I are hearing from the candidates. That's what you and I are hearing from mainstream legacy media. That's what you're hearing, maybe even from some of your own brothers and sisters in Christ, and how critical it is that we get the decision right. Not that there's ever been a four-year cycle or a presidential election that it wasn't important for us to be able to get our decisions right. And back in February at a fundraiser, President Joe Biden, then a candidate running for re-election, called former president and current Republican Party candidate for president Donald Trump the one existential threat to our nation. And what's the word existential mean? It means right now. It means like something that could affect the very survival of an organization or of an entity. So when you hear the word existential, it means the threat is real and it's now. And that was President Joe Biden's perspective, at least expressed perspective, back in February. His reelection team even went out on X, which formerly was Twitter, prior to its purchase by Elon Musk. And it said at that time that your freedom, your democracy, and even America itself is at stake. Back in July, current Vice President and now Democratic Party candidate for President Kamala Harris said, this is the one, the most existential, consequential, and important election of our lifetime. And that's an end quote. Former President Trump has himself used this line of argument as well, when back in June at the Faith and Freedom Coalition meeting, he said that this will be the most important election in the history of our country and our one chance to save America. Back in March of this year, in response to the claim that he was a threat to democracy, he retorted, I'm not the threat. I am the one that's ending the threat to democracy. You know, if you fully trust what these candidates for the office of the presidency are saying, there's an awful lot at stake with our decisions regarding this upcoming pending election. But as Caitlin Scheiss, author of the book Ballot and the Bible, How Scripture Has Been Used and Abused in American Politics, she expresses, these existential narratives are often more about scaring people into turning out to the polls to vote than they are about fostering dialogue about important issues that are necessary for us to talk about. What can we as believers do to properly process all of the racket, to keep all of the noise that we're hearing, certainly and especially as Christians and as followers of Christ, how do we keep all of this in proper eternal perspective? How do we properly discern how we as Americans should respond at this key moment of decision in the life of our nation? Seeking to approach this topic, we're talking about a lot of different topics in this series entitled Taboo. How can God's holy word be of help to us when it comes to decisions relating to our nation's governance and associated politics? Does the Bible say anything about the body of Christ, the church, that is, all of us as believers, and our role in the political affairs of our nation and world? As we have seen practically every issue that we have confronted over the last few months in this sermon series, Taboo, a critical spiritual discipline in the daily life of every believer, if we're going to respond to the things that we encounter face-to-face every day, is our dependence, the most critical spiritual discipline. And maybe I would argue maybe one of the most critical, because certainly you can, our dependence on prayer is critical. but our desire to seek after Christ and not only be able to speak to Him, because in prayer is when we get our opportunity to speak to the Lord, predominantly to speak to the Lord. But when it comes to hearing God's voice, you can do that during prayer, but you especially do that when you're in God's Word, listening, reading, and studying, and asking the Holy Spirit to reveal truth to us. Whose voice, whose wisdom, knowledge, and understanding are most important to you and me? Our actions determine that. Our actions demonstrate that. I wonder if you and I fully recognize the true treasure that is the well-known words of the old Kingsmen Quartet song, "I can't even walk without you holding my hand." The lyrics of this song exclaim that this life we're living in is fraught with sinking sand, with mountains so high and the valleys so wide. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand, 'cause I can't even walk, you can't even walk, without God holding your hand. Now, when you heard me start slinging around politicians' names this morning, any of y'all go, "Uh-oh, wait a minute now. We're not really supposed to talk about politics here in church, right?" Isn't that right? There's a law that was passed that basically makes 501(c). And 501(c), you know what that is, right? That's a designation, a line in the IRS tax code that makes nonprofits, and there's various different nonprofits, and there's various different line items in the tax code that basically essentially dictate that if you are a charitable organization, that you would not pick, that you would not stand here, I would not stand here as a representative of this organization and tell you who you are to vote for. And I won't do that. But I will, and I feel convicted over these next couple of weeks to make sure you understand the stakes and to make sure you understand the policies, if you will, and the topics that you need to be thinking about and you need to be praying through in order for you to make the very best decision that's going to affect the direction, it's going to affect the daily lives, the eternal destinations of citizens in our country and even citizens of other nations all around the world. I'm here to remind you this morning that you should never walk into a ballot box and cast a vote without first going to the only one who can enable you to make the wise choice. To know that we as human beings are insufficient and we're incapable of making a great decision apart from God and in our own fleshly capabilities, that is great wisdom that can only come from above. To know that you're insufficient, to know that a branch apart from the vine can't produce fruit, can't do anything of any eternal worth, of anything that's going to matter 1,000 years from now, that should be your desire, my desire, when we as believers and as followers of Christ walk into the ballot box and execute our God-given rights as a member of this republic to vote your conscience, to vote your morals, to vote the convictions that God and the Holy Spirit have given to you and me. We are desperately dependent upon the revelation and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And it's only through our submission to Christ that we're going to be able to make an eternal difference, that you as an individual Christian, we as a body of believers are going to make an eternal difference in the life of this nation, the life of the state that we live in, the life of the city or town that you're a part of, even the neighborhood that you're living in. In 1 Kings chapter 3, shortly after King David made his son Solomon king of Israel, he charged him with some advice and some steps that he should take to shore up, to certify in concrete, if you will, his new reign as the new king. And in verse 5, it reveals that God came to Solomon in a dream, and he stated to Solomon, he said, "Ask for whatever you want me to give to you." Wow. Can you imagine God coming to you in a dream and giving you an option? Ask of me anything that you desire. And when given the chance to have anything that he could have prayed for, Solomon responded by honoring God and acknowledging how he had so richly blessed his father's reign. And then he goes on to ask in verse 9. He says, "So give your servant a discerning heart to govern your people and distinguish between right and wrong. For who is able to govern this great people of yours?" And we're told in verse 10 that the Lord was so pleased that Solomon had asked this, that in verse 12, God says, it's recorded, "I will give you a wise and discerning heart as you ask, so that there will never be anyone like you, nor will there ever be." How powerful is that? For the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God who's created everything, to be so pleased with a man's prayer that he would tell him that there'll never be anyone like you, never anyone like you ever again. Now let me ask you, was Solomon perfect as best we know? Absolutely not. Did God know that when he answered this prayer? Did God know what Solomon's life was going to be like 10 years, 20 years, 30 years down the line? Did he realize the mistakes that Solomon was going to make as a man in the flesh? Did God know that? How in the world could God say this knowing that he was going to be like he was in the future? Because, you know, God is transcendent. He's beyond this world, beyond time. He knows all. He's all-powerful. He's everywhere present. He's omnibenevolent. He's all-giving and all-blessing to us. But the fact of the matter is God's working a plan, and God knows. And God never makes a decision, and he never states a word in the absence of all of eternity. And so God went on to bless Solomon immensely beyond what he humbly asked for, to include, he said, "I'll give you not only what you asked, but I'll give you riches and honor so that in his lifetime he would be, or he would have, no equal among all the kings of the world." I'm not really focused on all the riches and all the power and how Solomon turned out or any of that stuff. What I'm more concerned about this morning for you and I is that as we each day have to make decisions on behalf of our families, on behalf of our very selves, on behalf of our countries, on behalf of the companies that we work for, on behalf of this church, on behalf of small groups and people that God's given some of you as leaders in this church responsibility to be steward over, to be shepherds of. We have more than one shepherd in this church. We have many shepherds in this church that are in positions of leadership who have responsibility over the spiritual lives and even the physical lives of people that we live with and that we call close to us. What does it practically mean for a believer to have a discerning heart? Discernment is a form of wisdom. Pastor Timothy Keller, in his book, God's Wisdom for Navigating Life, describes discernment this way. He states it means the ability to notice distinctions and shades of difference where others only see a blur. For instance, in the case of his wife, Kathy, she could see small differences between the performance of ballet dancers because she used to be one, and she knew what to look for. Just like in Tim's case, he could tell you the special nuances and the quality of a curveball, unlike his wife who knew not much at all about baseball. I look at my brother. I've always been amazed at my brother that he's always had the ability to be able to break down. He's a golfer. He's always been a golfer. Sometimes he's an angry golfer, and he'll tell you that because he's such a persnickety person when it comes. My brother was built to win. I was built to care about winning, but not losing my life over it. But I mean, my little brother, back when he was playing T-ball years ago on the mound, you know, every year in T-ball, you always have that player, that one player on the team that's like the Hoover, that every ball gets hit, it gets sucked up by that player. The player's all over the field. That was my brother. But in my brother's case, my brother has the ability to break down a golf swing and to be able to figure out, because a ball goes a certain way, what exactly happens and what in the mechanics need to be adjusted and changed in order to be able to improve, if you will, improve or fix your shot before you swing the next time. That's what I can't do. It's the reason why I'm in the trees one moment I'm right in the center of the green. The worst possible place for you to put me is right in front of the green, 100 yards out, waiting for me to put that ball right around the pin, because I'll go right, I'll go left, I'll go over past it, I'll fall short of it, I'll put it in the trap. But the last place I'll put it is a foot from the cup, much less in the cup. And the fact remains that our ability to discern, discern what's really, really important, whether you make a 62 in golf or 72 ain't going to affect this world. But whether or not you put the wrong leader into a position of authority over a country of 330 million people, that matters. And that's important. To be wise in discerning. Pastor Keller says, biblical wisdom brings discernment to the skill of daily living, of life itself. To be wise and discerning is to recognize multiple options and possible courses of action where others can only imagine one or two. There are lots of different ways to describe discernment, but it's ultimately meaning the ability to be able to determine, as he says, for us, the ability to be able to tell the difference between right and wrong, and between good, better, and best. You know, I saw an article over the weekend. I don't know if any of you saw this. The Pope came out and decided to speak about U.S. election coming up. And the Pope's counsel and advice was to pick the lesser of the evils. So here is the head of the Catholic Church living in Italy, who's watching the news and paying attention to us. And he recognizes that we, unfortunately, as a nation, after being alive for roughly 250 years, that we're in a position right now where we're going to have to pick. If you trust the polls and you trust the fact that typically we as a nation, we're a two-party system here in this nation, and it's killing us because neither party has got it right. Neither party is where it needs to be on the most important issues of the day. And so the reality is, if you look back at history, the president of the United States in November, when all the votes come in, unless there is a miracle of biblical proportions, is going to come from one of these two key parties. And neither one of these individuals are spotless morally, spiritually, or in any other perspective that you may be able to look at them. And so being able to determine the difference between not just right and wrong, but between what's best for our nation, not what's good or what's better, but what's best for our nation, given the fact that we don't have a perfect choice, a perfectly moral choice from which to choose, is a challenge. Would you agree? And so don't you think you might need, or that I might need, that we as the church, that we as godly people, that we might need wisdom from above on how to make a decision when the options aren't the greatest in the whole world, when the stakes are so great for our country. But keeping in mind the fact that whatever happens in November or any election or any given day, God's still on his throne and God's still in charge. He's still large and he's still in charge. And that the word existential is really kind of out there. Maybe shouldn't necessarily, you know, come out of a Christian's mouth when it comes to politics, because we know God is the one who's on the throne and he's the one in charge no matter what. Why do I mention all of this in the context of our attention to the matter of Christianity and politics? Why do I talk about discernment? Solomon was wise to humbly pray for a discerning heart, and we would be no less wise to do the same if we desire, as God's children and servants, to make wise and Christ-honoring decisions when it comes to voting for candidates seeking to lead our nation's states, cities, and towns. In James chapter 1, verse 5, Jesus' half-brother exhorts us, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. It's only when we're operating in Christ in accordance with the Lord's will and the Holy Spirit's prompting that God-pleasing decisions are possible, especially in the most perplexing situations, certainly politics and our nation's governance being one of them. And this is where God's promise in 2 Chronicles 7:4 comes to the forefront. people think about patriotism, and you're hearing words like Christian nationalism and a lot of words that are being misdefined, if you will, or being new definitions being created for them that you can't necessarily trust in. You have to be discerning and being able to understand a person's heart and motive. But 2 Chronicles reminds us that if my people, God speaking here, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and will pray and will seek my face and will turn from their wicked ways, God promises us that he'll hear from heaven, that he'll forgive the person praying sin, and he'll restore their land. I think we should take God up on his promise. A little further into 1 Kings chapter 8 specifically, and we find Solomon dedicating the newly built temple to the Lord. And he prays the following words. He says, "Lord, the God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven, above or on the earth below. You who keep your covenant of love with your servants who continue wholeheartedly in your way. It is this God, that God, and him alone, whose wisdom we should all be seeking with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, and with all of our strength when it comes to any critical decisions regarding our nation, state, city, and town, and the ultimate welfare of those that we love and we care about." We're reminded by the Apostle Paul in Philippians 1:9 that as Christ's love grows and makes its home in our hearts, so increases the depth of godly insight that we need. The closer you come to Christ and the more intimate your relationship with him, the more God reveals his heart and his mind to you so that you and I can be confident in every decision that we make or in every step that we take when we face the things that are difficult to understand in this life. Author Mark Twain understood full well the important role that a believer plays when it comes to choosing its leaders. He wrote, "A Christian's first duty is to God. It then follows as a matter of course that it is his duty to carry out his Christian code of morals to the polls and vote them. If Christians should vote their duty to God at the polls, they would carry every election and do it with ease. It would bring about a moral revolution that would be incalculably beneficent. It would save the country." That's an end quote. What does it say about our nation and us as children, God's children in America, when we consider the state of our government and the way that too many of its decisions fail to align with God's word? What does it say about our nation when our nation's and or state and local leaders refuse to enforce and pass laws that prioritize and protect the lives of helpless unborn children in this country? What does it say about our nation and its leaders that our nation fails to address border policies that are allowing millions of foreigners we don't know anything about to cross over our country's borders and then use our finite, our limited tax dollars to care for them? What does it say about our nation that we have failed to protect a woman's rights to be able to safely enter a bathroom without the risk of coming face to face with a man dressed in women's clothing? What does it say about our local school leaders and various communities throughout our nation who allow men in drag to come into its schools and read stories to our children in its libraries? Those who allow lewd and inappropriate books entry onto the shelves of our libraries for our students to read. What does it say about our nation's leaders that they fail to publicly, unwaveringly, and unequivocally support the nation of Israel's rights to defend itself from terrorist nations who would illegally cross its borders and murder, rape, and kidnap not only its citizens, but also citizens of the United States of America, and then, in turn, turn around and harass, condemn, and interfere with Israel's efforts to pursue the deliverance of those hostages and hold the terrorists and those who support them accountable? I could go on and on. There are lots of issues out here in this world that I think it would be, you can make a very good argument for why we as a nation maybe aren't doing the best job in the world when it comes to dealing with these issues and a lot more. To protect God's people, God warns us throughout His Word against electing and putting ungodly people in positions of authority. To vote and allow individuals like these into positions of decision-making power and authority in our various levels of government is a direct violation of God's will. Spiritually incompetent decisions at the ballot box will surely translate into a price paid going forward into the future. Psalm 125:3 says this. It says, "For the scepter of the wicked shall not rest on the land allotted to the righteous, lest the righteous stretch out their hands to do wrong." 2 Samuel 23:3 says, "He who rules over men must be just, ruling in the fear of God." As true followers of Christ and citizens of this country, we have received a multitude of blessings from God, that along with all of these many blessings comes great responsibility. Our nation's system of self-government is a burden that requires the intentional stewardship and proactive involvement of believers if it's going to be faithful in doing the will of God here on earth as it is in heaven. There's no question that God desires that we do His will, not only in but also throughout our nation's government. This requires that we as Christians to step up and to do our part as His servants who love Him, Him being God, and are its citizens dedicated to being focused on the welfare and the protection of our nation in this country. The words of Noah Webster, American lexicographer, political writer, and author of the Webster Dictionary, are pertinent to our emphasis this morning. He expressed the following. He said, "In selecting men, and I would add women, for office, let principle be your guide. Regard not the particular sect of the denomination of the candidate. Look to his or her character. It is alleged by men of loose principles or defective views of the subject that religion and morality are not necessary or important qualifications for political stations. But the Scriptures teach a different doctrine. They direct that rulers should be men and women who rule in the fear of God, able men and women, such as fear God, men and women of truth, hating covetousness. When a citizen gives his or her vote to a man of known immorality, he abuses his civic responsibility. He sacrifices not only his own interest, but that of his neighbor. He betrays the interest of his country." Suffice it to say, too many of us as believers in this nation have been guilty of the sin of disobedience to the Lord by either commission or by omission. What do I mean by that? I mean that we, many of us, and I would confess even me, have there been times when I have walked in a ballot box and voted what I thought was the best thing to do, not necessarily what I prayed and asked God what the best decision was. I'm guilty. And I suspect that most of you, or maybe all of you, are guilty of having done this at least once in your life before. And so by commission, you can be guilty of disobedience to God by commission, by making decisions at the ballot booth that were not prayed about and were not properly investigated in advance, and thus our uninformed decisions demonstrated a lack of faith and a lack of trust and dependence upon our Father in heaven. If we don't believe we need to go to God and ask Him for wisdom in order to make good decisions in our daily lives, then what are we saying? What are we demonstrating the station of our faith and the station of our trust in God is? So you can make a sin of disobedience. You can commit a sin of disobedience by commission, by making steps and making decisions that you're not vetting through your relationship with the Lord. Or you can make it by omission. That is that we can prove to not be good steward of our responsibility to show up and to vote and play an active role in electing godly men and women who would guide our nation in the direction of our Lord's desires. Has there been a time when you knew it was voting day and you didn't choose to go vote? Maybe there's some of you here who aren't registered to vote. You've never voted. And maybe you've never voted because your parents didn't vote. Maybe you voted, but you vote the way you vote because your parents have always voted D, or your parents have always voted R, or your parents have always voted I. Or again, maybe you haven't voted, and you've left it up to everyone else to make a decision on behalf of our nation. In the absence of Christianity and the influence of biblical principles leading the way regarding decisions that affect not just our nation, but the remaining nations of the world, secularism and postmodernism, that is the absence of God and His absolute truth, those who believe in those things, who worship themselves and who worship a truth that they've come up with on their own, that is what's compromising and having a devastating effect on our nation. Add to this increasing efforts being invested, even today, to silence the voices of Christians. And in the words of Bill and Brad Bright, America is faced with the greatest crisis in its history. We are in danger of losing our nation and our God-given freedoms to those who disdain the God of our nation's founders. British statesman Edmund Burke said this. He said, "All that is necessary for the triumph of evil is for good men and women to do nothing." The truth is, America is one of the last strongholds of freedom on earth. It is incumbent upon you and I as believers here this morning, if you are a believer here this morning, to dedicate our lives to preserving this blessed and privileged estate afforded to us by God and our Savior and Lord, and the freedoms that come along with being a part of a free nation. This means that we as believers must recognize the stakes and respond accordingly. The Brights go on to exclaim, "Tens of millions of people in the United States profess faith in Jesus Christ." And let me go one step further. I saw a statistic here recently that said of professing Christians, upwards of 40 million Christians in every election don't vote, don't speak up. Citizenship in a republic like ours implies clear responsibilities for Christ followers that did not exist during the first century Roman Empire that was in rule over Israel. As we saw throughout our study of the book of Acts, a handful of dedicated believers acting by faith and trust in the power of God can turn an entire nation, even an entire world, upside down and can change the course of its history. So let me close this morning. We got more coming next week. Couldn't get it all in. But let me close with some words of Charles Finney, one who helped introduce 500,000 Americans to faith in Christ. In 1835, he wrote this. He said, "The time has come that Christians must vote for honest men and women and take consistent ground in politics, or the Lord will curse them. God cannot sustain this free and blessed country, which we love and pray for, unless the church will take right ground. Politics are a part of religion in such a country as this, and Christians must do their duty to the country as part of their duty to God. God will bless or curse this nation according to the course Christians take in politics." So as I close this morning, let me ask you a couple of questions. The first question is, are you confident that you have a habit of taking your questions, even your questions about who you should vote in an election, to God Himself? Are you confident in that, or do you need to be praying and asking God to help us be more faithful, to acknowledge that we need Him to speak truth into our lives in order to help us make the best decision for our nation? My second question this morning to you as we finish up is, are you registered to vote? If you are old enough here to vote, are you registered to vote? Has there been a time recently when you haven't voted? Maybe you haven't voted because you're not registered to vote. There's a link up here that I'm giving you. And you know what? I'll definitely do this. I'll definitely challenge you and exhort you. If you haven't voted, go ahead and flip to the next slide. Take a picture of this website. If you're not registered to vote, you can go online from the privacy of your own home, and you can type this link, paste this link into your browser server, and you can go vote. The deadline's coming up. The deadline to register to vote in the presidential election, if you want to vote in person, it's 30 days prior to the election, which means Friday, October the 4th is your deadline in order to be able to register to vote, if you want to vote in person. If you want to vote online or by fax or email, the deadline is Sunday, October the 6th to register. And if you want to register to vote by mail, it's Monday, October the 7th. But regardless, the first week in October is our deadline as believers for us to do our civic duty, the duty that God has blessed us and placed us in a republic, in a nation where the people are the ones that choose the leaders. We as responsible Christians have that responsibility to ensure that we are playing our part, our necessary part in voting our values and ensuring that only those who profess Christ as Lord and Savior receive your vote. And you know what? Don't worry about what's going on in Minnesota or what's going on in California. We have a responsibility right here in the state of South Carolina as folks who live in either Berkeley, Dorchester, you know, Charleston, or wherever it is that you live. We have a responsibility to make a difference right here by faith, trusting in God that He's got all this, that He knows what He's doing, and that He'll honor the wisdom that you express at the ballot box, especially if you've gone to Him first and asked Him to give you that wisdom and insight. We'll get into particulars about what the issues are that are at stake next week so that you can be informed, so that you can be informed and can make a God-honoring decision when you participate in the vote this coming November. So if you would, bow your heads, if you would, please. Father in heaven, Lord, we never want anything that Lord has preached or that is talked about in our lives or demonstrated in our lives to be anything but an expression of you, an expression of our submission to you, an expression of our worship to you. And so, Lord, I pray, Father, for each and every person that's here this morning within the sound of my voice, Lord, that you would speak into their hearts and minds, Lord, and that you would reveal wisdom and truth, that you would reveal direction and guidance to them about what steps they should take going forward as a citizen of the United States of America, Lord. That didn't happen by accident, Lord. You chose to bless us. You chose to place us here for such a time as this, Lord. Help us to make the kind of difference that only you can make when your Spirit in us is the one making the choices and decisions and expressing the actions of that which you would have us to express in our daily lives. And so, Lord, I pray now, Lord, as we enter this time of invitation, if there's anyone here who does not know you as Lord and Savior, Father, Lord, and you know each and every heart here, I pray that you would convict them here this morning to move from their seat, to be able to come forward and to stand and accept you once and for all as their Lord and Savior. And Lord, I pray that if there are some that need to move their hearts in such a way as they need to surrender themselves and submit themselves to you. Maybe there's something going on in their life that you desire that they would lift up to you. I pray that your Spirit would spur them on this morning, that they may come forward, Father. Get out on their knees here, Father, and lift up to you those things that, Lord, they've been resisting turning over to you up to this point. And I pray, Father, that they give us a chance to pray over them. Lord, I pray for someone who may not be a member of a church family or may not have a church family that's walking alongside them, Father. If there's someone here that needs to become part of this church family here at Santee Circle, Father, move them, Lord, I pray by your Spirit, move them out of their seat, bring them forward to make that most important decision, Father. I pray that you would be glorified and honored as we finish this service this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would, rise with me. If you need to make a decision this morning, if you need to accept Jesus Christ, if you need to come and be prayed for or to pray and lift something to God, if you need a church home, we'd love to talk to you more about that. You come.
Good morning, everyone. All right, we've got a few announcements for you this morning. First up, there is a CLM graduation that's happening tonight at Santee Circle Church of God across the street. That's going to be at 6 p.m. You guys make sure that you come out and support that. Next up, I'm going to invite Mr. Tommy up. He's got an announcement to make.
Thank you, Ms. Beth. Good morning. Thank you for letting me have a couple of minutes of your time this morning. My name is Tommy. I'm an ambassador for Christ as well as Change Lives Ministry. And we're a 13-week faith-based drug and alcohol rehabilitation center. We do not charge our men and women a fee to come. So the reason I came this morning was to announce one of our events, our fundraising events, which has become one of our marquee or one of our very significant fundraisers. And it's awesome because we get to leverage playing golf with raising funds. I myself am a horrible golfer, so I won't be playing. I got a couple other things going on. But this year, it's very exciting, and it's an honor to introduce our Memorial Change Lives Ministry Memorial Golf Tournament in memory of Dr. Mike Hill, who we are grateful to, a longtime board member, a good friend, and father figure as well. So it'll be on November 5th, at 10:30. Registration begins 11 o'clock lunch, and then 12 o'clock will be a shotgun start. $75 a person or $300 a team. So my job is to come and ask you to participate, but what I like to do is ask you to pray. Pray for us, pray for our staff, our board of directors, pray for the whole entire Change Lives Ministries, because the numbers for addiction, although this year there was not an increase in opioid deaths, cocaine and methamphetamines skyrocketed. So we continue this battle. We can't overcome drug addiction through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I know it because I've done it. I'm not just a spokesman. I am a satisfied customer. Everybody in this room has been affected one way or the other. Because if you pay taxes, I was looking those numbers up, billions of dollars go into this problem. And we have the answer right over there and on Main Street. And that is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. So what I came to say is, please pray for this event. Pray for your hearts, if God is moving in your hearts, because not only can we build community and leverage funds for Change Lives Ministry through this event, we build relationships there. And I'm going to offer you this. Don't tell the other churches that I'm going to do this. But if you'd like to come out and not play, but come out and eat lunch with us, give me a call ahead of time, and we'll make a spot for you so you can come and see how the Holy Spirit works at Change Lives Ministry. It'll be at Berkeley Golf and Country Club. You won't be disappointed, I guarantee it. And then I would ask, if God does lead you to that, that you would look for sponsorship opportunities financially or donations. Because as the problem gets bigger, we want to be able to continue to keep up with the demand of men and women who want to come and get the healing they so desperately need. So it's not just a golf tournament. It's a significant event in our community to benefit our community. And I think that is the way we'll overcome drug addiction. It's through our community. So I thank you for your time this morning. If you have any questions, see me. I'll be around. I'll be here through the next service. And I do thank you so much for all y'all's support, being our home church, and how you poured into my life through this last 7 years. That's a personal note. So thank you very much, and I love y'all. Thank you.
All right, they've got a video that they're going to show. Okay, let's see. So next up, we've got Church Work Day is coming up on October the 5th. That's going to be the day before our homecoming service. So that's going to be on Saturday from 8 until noon. Mr. Wayne always asks that you bring out all of the things, shovels, rakes, gloves, all that good stuff. If you have any questions about that, you can get with him. And then the very next day, like I said, is October the 6th. We're going to be celebrating Pastor Appreciation along with Homecoming on that Sunday. It's one service, going to be happening at 10:30. We're going to have a soup, salad, and dessert potluck immediately following that. If you have any questions about the food part or about the potluck after, you can get with Miss Becky Hill. Let's see. And then next up, we've got Fall Festival is quickly approaching. That's going to be on October the 19th. We're expecting a really big crowd. So if you have, if you're able to help out that day and you've not talked to me, then please do. I know that there's somewhere that we can use you. If you have neighbors, nieces, nephews, grandchildren, make sure that you bring them out. It's going to be a really fun time. Again, that's on October the 19th. Let's see. Next up, Crossroads Summer Camp. This summer is going to be happening July the 14th through the 18th. There's a $50 deposit due for that on October the 13th. Total is going to be $335. If you have questions about that, you can get with Pastor Andrew. I know that we always say, as far as camp goes, don't let money hold you back. There's always people that are willing to donate to have scholarships for the kids. So make sure that if that's something that you're interested in, that you get with Pastor Andrew or Miss Michaela about that. And then let's see, last, if we have any first-time visitors here today, we're so glad to have y'all. Make sure that you fill out one of the cards that's in front of you in the back of the chair there. If you turn it in at the front desk, then they'll have a little something for you. And I think that's it.
All right, let's stand up and worship together one last time as we dismiss.
Seen some mighty big canyons that you brought me through. Seen some mighty big mountains that you stuck and moved. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Yeah, that's my soul. Walking with my Father. Shepherd.